Macmillan Audio presents Q, A Voyage Around the Queen, by Craig Brown. Read for you by Harriet Walter.
With additional reminiscences read by me, Craig Brown. One does what one is. One becomes what one does. Robert Musil. It's you they want to meet, but it's themselves they want to talk about. Cyril Connolly. Without their crowns and coronets, how could the English be distinguished from Icelanders? John Updike.
1. The London Gazette, 21st of April, 1926. Her Royal Highness the Duchess of York was safely delivered of a princess at 17 Bruton Street, Mayfair. His Royal Highness the Duke of York and the Countess of Strathmore were present. Secretary William Joynson Hicks was also present. Her Royal Highness and the infant princess are doing perfectly well. The happy event was made known by the firing of the Park and Tower guns. 2. Also born in April 1926 were Hugh Hefner, J.P. Dunleavy, Harper Lee and Ian Paisley. And that same year, Miles Davis, Fidel Castro, Michel Foucault, Chuck Berry, Marilyn Monroe and David Attenborough. Claude Monet died in 1926, and so did Harry Houdini, Rudolph Valentino, Rainer Maria Rilke, and Annie Oakley. New songs that year included Are You Lonesome Tonight, Bye Bye Blackbird, Tiptoe Through the Tulips, and Someone to Watch Over Me. The television was invented in 1926, and so were the aerosol can, the electric lawnmower, the bulldozer, the combine harvester, cellophane, and traffic lights. Among the words and expressions first chronicled in 1926 were Bible Belt, Business Lunch, Car Park, Kitsch, Market Research, Pop Song, Publicity Stunt, Recycle, Sugar Daddy, and Totalitarian.
3. A few days after my mother's death in the spring of 2023, I was sorting through cupboards when I came across a navy blue leather photograph album filled with old black and white photographs of soldiers marching, crowds waving, dignitaries standing in line, and the 25-year-old Princess Elizabeth smiling and shaking hands. What was it doing there? On the first page, handwritten in navy blue ink, italic script, with the capital letters finished off in red and gold, was this. On Thursday, the 21st of June 1951, the old colours of the 3rd Battalion Grenadier Guards were laid up in Manchester Cathedral in the presence of Her Royal Highness the Princess Elizabeth, Duchess of Edinburgh, Colonel of the Regiment. This pictorial record is sent to Mrs. Moncrief Brown by the President of the Manchester Branch Grenadier Guards Comrades Association as a happy reminder of a memorable occasion. Mrs. Moncrief Brown was my grandmother. 13 full-page photographs charted the young princess's progress through Manchester on that day, three quarters of a century ago. Her arrival at London Road Station, the parade of Grenadier Guards leaving the police headquarters en route to the cathedral via Albert Square, Piccadilly and Market Street, the arrival of Her Royal Highness at the cathedral, the Lord Mayor in all his finery, presenting her to the sub-dean, the Bishop of Middleton, and the Lord Bishop of Manchester, the march past at Albert Square, and the salute outside the town hall, through to the presentations. Under the heading Presentations, a photograph shows the princess passing along a line of men and women. Those she has just spoken to look a good deal more relaxed than those she is about to speak to. And there, two along from Mr. C.G.S. Piggott, Honourable Secretary, Manchester Branch, Comrades Association, whom the Princess seems to be addressing, and his wife, named sparely as Mrs. Piggott, is my grandmother, Mrs. G. Moncrief Brown. I remember her as an old lady, sharp and delightful, always at hand with treats like crunchy bars and Kit Kats. She could play the ukulele and was skilled with her hands, sewing fancy little toy mice dressed in their Sunday best, which in the early 1970s were on display in a glass cabinet in the Imperial Hotel Torquay and for sale in a gift shop on a cobbled street opposite Windsor Castle. What was she doing there in Manchester being presented to Princess Elizabeth on Thursday the 21st of June 1951? In the photograph, she is looking down the line towards Mr. C.G.S. Piggott with a smile. She was born in 1892, so back then she would have been 59 years old. But compared to most of the dumpy, severe women in the surrounding photographs, she looks to me much younger, dainty and elegant in her exotic headdress. I never knew her husband, my grandfather, Andrew Moncrief Brown. He killed himself in 1940 when he was barely 50. His two sons, my father Peter and his brother Ian, were away at the war. My father told me that my grandfather was a demanding man, unforgiving towards waiters, often drunk and prone to great rages. Over dinner, he would regularly pick a fight with my grandmother before storming off, slamming the door behind him. On the night of the 1st of September, 1940, he embarked on another of his perennial tantrums and stormed off, slamming the door, leaving my grandmother alone at the table. The silence was broken by a gunshot. Seconds later, my grandfather staggered back into the dining room, blood gushing from his stomach. He managed to splutter, "Now look what you've made me do." They were his last words. When my father was given the news by his commanding officer, he collapsed. In the First World War, Andrew Moncrief Brown had been a cavalry officer in the Grenadier Guards, riding a horse into battle while brandishing a sword. In the 1990s, my father gave my little son that sword. It still sits on a shelf in its battered leather sheath. My father's elder brother Ian had followed his father into the Grenadier Guards. 3 years after my grandfather's suicide, on the 10th of September 1943, I.A. Moncrief Brown, 2nd Lieutenant, 6th Battalion Grenadier Guards, service number 130875, son of Andrew Moncrief Brown and Gwendolyn Mary Brown, was killed in combat at Salerno at the age of 26. He's buried in the war cemetery at Salerno. Within the space of 3 years, my father had lost both his father and his brother. He was still only 23. No one in human history lived a more chronicled life than the Queen. We can chart her movements on an almost daily basis from the moment she was born to the moment she died. There was barely a week in her 96 years when she was not photographed, often by hundreds or even thousands of people. In no time at all, we can find out where she was and what she was doing on just about any day in her long, long life. We know who her great-great-great-great-great-great-grandparents were, their characters and habits, their successes and failures, their likes and dislikes, the rumours surrounding them. We know her cousins and her sister and her uncles and her aunts. We know her children and their children and their children, and many of us hold strong opinions about this one or that. Like it or not, like them or not, the royal family are under our skin. Much of the late Queen's life was filmed for public consumption. With my grandmother's photo album in front of me, all I have to do is tap a few words on a keyboard and up pops a Pathé news special on Princess Elizabeth's visit to Manchester on the 21st of June, 1951. Princess Elizabeth alights from her train, smiling, her hand already outstretched, ready for the shaking. "Greeted by the Lord Lieutenant, Lord Derby, Princess Elizabeth arrives in Manchester for one of the most colourful spectacles seen in the city for years," exclaims the Pathé commentator in his clipped voice. "With the Lord Mayor, she leaves for Manchester Cathedral, where the 3rd Battalion, the Grenadier Guards, are to lay out their old colours." We watch her walk along the platform, accompanied by a man in tails, holding his top hat behind him. Grandees follow them at a discreet distance, medals pinned to their lapels. They passed slightly tattered Union Jacks, draped here and there along the platform, possibly covering up something unsightly. The film cuts to a marching band in their uniforms and busbies parading through the city centre, followed by more soldiers with raised bayonets. Jubilant crowds cheer. The detachment is accompanied by the Manchester branch of the Grenadier Guards Old Comrades Association, explains the commentator. He speaks in a series of exclamations. The princess, who is a colonel of the Grenadiers, recently presented new colours to the 3rd Battalion on behalf of the King. We are now outside Manchester Cathedral. The princess is shaking hands with senior clerics, including the Lord Bishop of Manchester and the Bishop of Middleton. A man with a chain of office in a big fluffy hat and a coat fringed with ermine glances at his little notepad, taking care to get their names and titles right before presenting them. And now, before the town hall, their old colours safely laid up, the Grenadiers march past their colonel. The marching band plays the British Grenadiers. Like many schoolboys of the 1960s, I still have the words in my head. Some talk of Alexander and some of Hercules, of Hector and Lysander, and such great names as these. But of all the world's brave heroes, there's none that can compare with the tow-row-row-row-row-row-row to the British Grenadiers. Men in flat caps and suits and ties gaze at the princess. Stocky old women with floral hats wave hankies and cheer. When did crowds stop waving their handkerchiefs? It was a strange tradition when you come to think of it, though altogether friendlier than our contemporary practice of shielding our faces with iPhones. By entrusting their old colours to the safekeeping of Manchester Cathedral, the 3rd Grenadiers mark their close association between the regiment and the city. Men in suits and trilbies march proudly in serried columns behind the soldiers, their chests stacked with medals. From this area, it draws more recruits than from any other outside London. The Grenadiers know where to look for good men when they want them. The Pathé News report on YouTube finishes there, but the last photograph in my grandmother's album takes the story a little further. Lord and Lady Derby say farewell to Her Royal Highness at London Road Station. The princess stands at the open window of a railway carriage, ready to depart. Perhaps she looks a little too happy. I assume that my grandmother was invited to join the group of bigwigs presented to Her Royal Highness because she was the widow of one grenadier officer and the bereaved mother of another. Perhaps she was on some committee or other. I should know, just as I should know 100 other things about her. Where was she living at the time? 11 years after her husband's suicide, had she married again? We always knew her as Granny Lane because she had at some point married a man called Lane, whose Christian name none of us can remember. What happened to Lane? As children, we never saw him. Perhaps he was already dead by the time we came along in the late 1950s. I remember my mother telling me that he was a wanderer and that one day he just wandered off, leaving my grandmother alone. I know that my grandmother's maiden name was Sidebottom. It's a name we always found funny. She once joked with us, at least I think it was a joke, that her parents pronounced it Sidebottome. Ancestry.com informs me that she was born on the 1st of March 1892 in Bowden, Cheshire, that her father was Edward John Sidebottom, also born in Bowden, Cheshire, 1860 to 1929, and that her mother was Benedicta Mary Adams, born in Bodmin, Cornwall, 1869 to 1956. But that's as far as it goes. I don't know what my great-grandparents did or what they looked like or how they managed to meet, given that one was from Cornwall and the other from Cheshire. In fact, I know nothing of them but their names. Of Queen Elizabeth II's great-grandparents, on the other hand, I know plenty. Her great-grandfather was King Edward VII, the rakish son of Queen Victoria, who found him irritating.
"Alas, I feel very sad and anxious about him. He's so idle and weak," she wrote in her journal in 1858 when he was 17.
For one reason or another, I've read two biographies of Edward VII over the years, one by Giles St. Aubyn of 555 pages, and the other by Jane Ridley of 608 pages. Edward VII married the steadfast Princess Alexandra of Denmark, subject of at least three biographies. I've also read three biographies of his son, the Queen.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.